All right, this is our lecture number 12, I'm guessing. In this lecture, we're going to continue discuss inferential statistics. Reminder, in the previous couple of lectures, we talked about how we can use statistical technique called confidence interval to estimate a couple of things. In case of numerical data, we can estimate the population mean. And in case of the categorical data, where we cannot really calculate the means, averages, we were trying to estimate population proportion. The example that we used was about exit polls, right? So trying to use the results of the exit polls in order to predict which candidate, Republican or Democratic, will win. So this was our first step in inferential statistics. And inferential, it's called inferential because we're using sample, very small portion of the population, in order to make conclusions or inferences about the population overall. So today we're going to actually start topic that we will continue throughout the rest of this semester. That would be hypothesis testing. So today, in this lecture, we're going to just discuss conceptual concepts behind what is hypothesis testing and how it's done. So let's kind of start from statistics, which is from the example, which is not statistical. Hypothesis testing in real life. Criminal trial. So when there is something goes on that in the court where, you know, somebody is being accused of doing something illegal, then the jury that's present in the courtroom has to decide between two different alternatives. Alternative number one, that the defendant, whoever is being accused, is innocent until proven guilty. So this is accepted as the starting assumption. Jury doesn't know the defendant. There is a good chance that this is the first time they're seeing the defendant at all. So they have no clue whether or not he or she is guilty or innocent, but they start with the assumption, which is called null hypothesis, that the defendant is innocent until proven guilty. That's the main principle. Alternative hypothesis that they have to consider is the defendant is actually guilty. Now the jury, as I said, does know which one is true. So first one may be true, or the alternative might be true. They have to make the decision based on the evidence that is brought to the courtroom by the other party, right? So somebody's accusing the defendant, so they have to provide the evidence in order to convince the jury that defendant is not innocent, so abandon null hypothesis and now believe that the alternative is true, that the defendant is guilty. So convicting the defendant is called rejecting null hypothesis in favor of alternative. So the jury is saying that in that case, when we're abandoning our initial belief that the defendant is innocent, then the jury basically saying that the evidence presented in the courtroom is sufficient enough, it's strong enough to support that the, you know, we believe based on what you presented in the courtroom that the defendant is actually guilty. So your evidence supports quite well the alternative hypothesis. If on the other hand the evidence presented is not sufficient, it's, you know, he says, she says, it's my word against his word, that kind of stuff, and it's not really substantiated, so it can be it can be accidental or just not very believable, then the jury will acquit the defendant. So they're going to clear him or her from any accusations, and therefore they will still believe that the defendant is innocent. Now again, they don't know actually if it's true or not. They might be guilty. The what happened in the court in that case is that the evidence presented was not strong enough, not convincing enough in order to abandon the belief that the defendant is innocent and now support the hypothesis that the defendant is guilty. So we never say that we accept the null hypothesis. We just say that we don't have enough evidence to reject. That's it. he might be guilty still, right? Even after the evidence was presented and was found not significant, might be still guilty. But the jury will say, okay, evidence is not hard and incriminating enough, so we're not going to abandon our initial belief that the defendant is actually innocent. So the null hypothesis still stands. Now, there are two possible errors that can happen, obviously, right? So, type one error happens when we reject a true null hypothesis. So, null hypothesis was that the defendant was innocent, and if jury found that the evidence in court is incriminating enough, and they rejected the true null hypothesis, they're obviously doing the wrong thing, right? They're basically sending the person who didn't do anything to jail, possibly, right? And that's considered to be type one error. Reject the null hypothesis, which actually was true. Now, another error is also possible. It could be that the alternative is true. In other words, the defendant is guilty, but the jury didn't find the evidence incriminating and just let the person go, right? So in that case, they're again making an error. They didn't find evidence incriminating, therefore they're acquitting a person who in fact was guilty, and that is called type 2 error. So this table in the slides summarizes what I just described, right? So the actual situation can be one of the two different ways, right? Null hypothesis could be true, the defendant is innocent, or alternative could be actually true, that the defendant is guilty. And this is what the jury can find. They can still stick with null hypothesis, still believe at the end of the trial that the defendant is innocent. Therefore, they failed to reject the null. Evidence was not incriminating enough. They still believe the null, that the person is innocent. And another possible outcome is they found evidence strong and incriminating enough, and they do reject null in favor of alternative and conclude that the person is guilty. Now, if they fail to reject the null and the null is actually true, they're doing the right thing. So the person is innocent, and they're concluding that evidence is not strong enough, still innocent. If, on the other hand, defendant was guilty, alternative is true, and they rejected null, started to believe alternative based on the evidence, they're doing the right thing again, right? They're stating that the defendant is guilty and we saw enough evidence of that. So these two possibilities are actually what's supposed to happen. But every once in a while, they reject the true null hypothesis. So if null is true and they still reject it based on the evidence, they're convicting a person, and that is type 1 error. So rejecting true null hypothesis is type 1 error, as we just discussed, and failing to reject, so if we fail to reject the null, fail to believe that the defendant is guilty, but in fact they were guilty, then we're actually making type 2 errors, okay? So four different possibilities. All right. In hypothesis testing, the probability of type 1 error rejecting the true null hypothesis is called significance level, and we're using Greek letter alpha for that. There is another chance that type 2 error will happen, and the probability of that is we're going to use different letter beta, right? And the two probabilities are inversely related. In other words, if the probability of type 1 error goes up, probability of type 2 error goes down, and vice versa. Okay, so why is that happening? Well, for example, let's say that we want the evidence to be really incriminating, so really hard and convincing, in order to send people to jail. All right. In other words, the jury will use actually pretty stringent process to screen the evidence. All right, and in this case, in order to incriminate person, you need to have really, really solid evidence presented in the court, okay? So this will minimize the chance that people who are actually innocent will be convicted, right? Because, you know, you need hard evidence against them, and if they're innocent, you need hard evidence against them, and if they're innocent, then probably it will be hard to find such evidence. So therefore, we're minimizing type 1 error, right? Convicting innocent people. At the same time, what can happen is if some people are truly guilty, and again we're requiring really solid evidence, then in such cases, such evidence will be hard to collect, simple as that, right? So therefore, jury will not find, in more cases, will not find people guilty, even though they were guilty, because in their mind, evidence was not solid and hard enough, right? So therefore, we're increasing the likelihood of guilty people going free. So minimizing likelihood of type 1 error increases the likelihood probability of type 2 error, and vice versa, okay? All right, now in practice, in not in statistics, but in judicial practice, type 1 error is considered to be more serious, and indeed that probably is justified, right? Because what's type 1 error? Convicting innocent people, that's what type 1 error is. So jury and general law practice tries to avoid situations when innocent people are being sent to jail. So we're willing to acquit guilty people and let them go, as opposed to sending as much people in jail as possible, right? So burden of proof in the court lies on the prosecution. The defense doesn't need to do anything from the get-go. The prosecution that brings the accusations needs to prove, you know, that this person is guilty of whatever he's being accused of doing, right? So if they don't present any evidence in the court, then the defense doesn't have to do really anything. So the burden of proof lies on the prosecution. The jury is instructed to find the defendant guilty only when the evidence presented in the court is beyond a reasonable doubt. So in other words, you know, somebody is accused of robbing the gas station, okay, and they're saying, no, I'm not guilty, it's all hearsay, I wasn't there. Well, okay, so here's your fingerprints, okay, here's the video recording from the security cameras, here are the 5 witnesses that identified you, here is the, I don't know, gun with your fingerprints. So this is evidence beyond a reasonable doubt. In this case, jury will go ahead and accuse person of being, you know, of doing whatever they're being accused. Okay, so in the criminal law, it's called Blackstone principle, that says it's better to ten guilty people will escape the justice than one innocent person will suffer. So again, type 1 error is considered to be more serious, and therefore evidence should be really, really incriminating for people to be convicted. Okay, so to summarize, what is hypothesis testing? There are 2 hypotheses to begin with, null and alternative. And pretty much they're saying opposite things, right? Null says person is innocent, alternative says person is guilty. So the procedure begins with a jury believing the null hypothesis, the person is innocent. That's their starting point. And the goal is to find out if there is enough evidence at our disposal to support the alternative hypothesis. If, and there are 2 possible outcomes, right? If there is enough evidence so that we start believing alternative more, then we're going to reject the null in favor of alternative and assume that the alternative now is true. But if the evidence is not hard enough, not convincing or incriminating enough, we're going to say, well, okay, that's a nice story, but I don't see that very convincing, actually. So therefore, I'm still going to believe the null hypothesis because there's not enough ground for me to believe the otherwise alternative. So in this case, we fail to reject the null. We still stick with the null. All right, so how does that apply to statistics? Well, very simple. In statistics, that's what we're going to be doing for the rest of the semester, right? We want to find out properties of the populations, such as what is the true population mean, or what is the true population proportion, if we're talking about categorical data, when we cannot calculate the mean, and the only thing that we can calculate is the proportion of certain response in the population, right? the only thing that we have about population is a sample. We discussed already that whatever we calculate from the sample can be sample average, x bar, or can be sample proportion, p with a hat on the top of it, they are not going to be equal to the population mean and the or population proportion. But sample, in a sense, presents evidence. So this is our evidence, and from this evidence we're going to make conclusions about population, about certain statements about the population. Does my sample support statements about the population mean or the proportion, or does it not support that statement? So we're going to formulate some beliefs, what we believe population mean is or population proportion is, and then based on the sample we're going to make a judgment call, right? Is that belief justified or is it not justified? Okay, so our belief will be expressed in the form of alternative hypothesis, right? Just like in the court of law, our hypothesis that we're trying to investigate is defendant guilty, after that we bring the evidence in court, on the statistical court it's called sample, and based on the sample we make a judgment. Okay, so samples serve as evidence. All right, so just like in the criminal proceedings, there are two hypotheses, null and alternative. None represents status quo. That's basically either current belief or situation, business as normal, business as usual. Okay, alternative is, so for example, people, generally speaking, people are good, right? So therefore, defendant is guilty. That's status quo. That's kind of how things should be under normal circumstances. But every once in a while, we have somebody who is guilty of doing something wrong, right? And that's our research hypothesis. We're trying to investigate, trying to find out if the person is guilty, maybe. Okay, so same thing will happen on our statistical testing. Null hypothesis is going to be a statement which represents either general belief or normal, usual situation. Alternative would be our research statement. Okay, so important thing, null and alternative hypothesis should together cover all range of possibilities. So they should be, so to speak, complementary. So when we're talking about criminal proceedings, person is innocent, person is guilty, these are two mutually exclusive statements, and together they constitute 100% of possibilities, right? Either person is guilty or they're not. Same thing in statistics. If we put null and alternative together, that should give us everything, all possibilities. So let's give it a practical spin. So let's say we're running a bottling plant where we fill in 1 gallon jugs with milk. So the normal, usual, you know, 1 gallon bottles that you can buy in any grocery store. So if on the outside of the bottle, on the label, it says the content is equal to 1 gallon, that's what it's supposed to be. Now, in the previous class, we discussed that in actuality, that doesn't happen, right? Every bottle is different. You can't make them exactly identical because there is variability which is present in the process, which is inherent to the process, right? So if you have like milk being filled into the bottles by an automatic equipment, right? So it has the shut off valve, and if the valve shuts off millisecond later as opposed to millisecond earlier, then you put a little bit extra, or vice versa, right? Don't fill it up until exactly 1 gallon, the bottle. But that's normal, that's what's expected, right? Variability is present in life, it's just general statement, okay? So, normally, the average amount of milk that we would put in the 1 gallon bottle would be 1.0. So, again, important thing here is I'm talking about averages, right? On average, I'm filling the bottles with 1.0 gallons of milk. That would be the normal situation. Some bottles can go higher than that, some bottles can be lower than that, but on average it's 1.0. Alternative would be as null, what null is not, right? Remember in the previous slide we discussed that null and alternative cover all range of possibilities. So if my null says that the average is equal to 1.0, alternative should say, no, it's not. Average is not equal to 1.0. And it doesn't specify exactly in which direction my average is not 1.0, right? Could be above, could be below. It's just different from 1. That's what it says. So this is our status quo statement, right? On average, I should fill my bottles with 1 gallon of milk. But if my average drifts away from 1.0, for whatever reason, right? Equipment goes out of tune, or, you know, milk spills out, whatever the reason might be, then I have a problem, right, in the production process. And this is when alternative comes to play. Do we have a problem in our production manufacturing process, so that my average is not 1.0 anymore, it's either above or below? Another possibility, let's say I'm still running my milk plant, right, bottling plant, but I get a call from the retailer who carries my product, and it says, hey, you know what, recently I had a lot of customer complaints. They're saying that when they open these bottles with milk, it looks like they're underfilled. So like some amount of underfilled bottles is normal, right? Bottles are not filled up to the brim, but when customers open them up, it's like a lot of air in the bottle. So could it be that my friend, you are underfilling, like whatever the reason might be, like for example your equipment is getting clogged with some residue, right? Therefore your flow of milk is impaired, and you just don't put enough milk in the bottle. Could you look at your production process? So in this case, that becomes my research statement, right? So, and it's always easier to start formulating your null and alternative with an alternative, because alternative again contains your research hypothesis. Whoops, that's not a good thing to have in the middle of the lecture. Somebody's calling. All right, give me a second. Okay, and we're back. So my research statement is I have a suspicion that I'm underfilling my bottles, right? And the average amount of milk that I put in the bottle on average is below what it's supposed to be, below 1.0. Now my null is opposite of the alternative, right? The alternative says that the average is less than 1. The null should be that the average is still 1.0 or more than that. Okay, so that's another form of the null and alternative. And yet another scenario, if my operations manager, let's say I'm running the plant, I'm CEO of the bottling company, and operations manager comes to me and says, hey, my quality control personnel, they do random checks. They were checking, you know, some bottles that come out of our production lines, and they're saying that they're overfilled, all of them pretty much. So could it be that we have again equipment out of tune, so that we put more milk per bottle than what we're supposed to? So in this case, my research hypothesis is going to be this, that the mean amount, average amount of milk that I put in 1 gallon bottle exceeds 1 gallon. And therefore null, which is opposite of alternative, is that no, average is still 1 or less than 1. So to summarize, hold on, I should have it somewhere. No, I don't have it. Okay, I thought that I have this slide. To summarize, we have three different forms of null and alternative. For number one, null has equal sign, alternative just plain equal, and alternative is not equal. So that's form number one. Form number two, null is greater than or equal, and alternative is less than. And form number three, null is less than or equal, and alternative is greater than. So three different forms how we can record our hypothesis when testing population mean. Or later in this lecture, well, next lecture probably, We're going to discuss population proportions, but same rules apply. Three forms of null and alternative: equal, not equal, greater than or equal, less than or equal, greater than. Okay. Note also that the equal sign is always present in the null hypothesis. So here equal is in the null, here equal is in the null, and here equal is in the null. So equal sign is always a property of the null hypothesis. So let's give it a spin, right? Let's have some practice formulating the hypothesis, null and alternative. So this one right here. A random sample of 100 young adult men was selected. Each person was asked how many minutes of sports daily they watch on TV. The hypothesis, null and alternative, should test which hypothesis, null and alternative, should we test to see if there is enough evidence from this 100 observation sample to conclude that the mean amount of TV watched daily is greater than 50 minutes. Remember, I told you about 5-10 minutes ago that we always look for the research statement or challenging assumption, and that becomes our alternative, right? So here we want to investigate if the average amount of daily TV minutes is higher than 50. So that becomes my alternative hypothesis. So I can record the mean amount of TV watched daily is over 50. And therefore, opposite of that becomes my null, that the mean is 50 or less. Okay, good. So, another one. We took random sample of 87, weird number 87, university students, CNU, enrolled in statistical thinking, BUSN 231. Each student was asked how many hours he or she spends doing homework in business statistics. The instructor recommends that the total homework time should be at least 5 hours per week in order to continue progressing nicely in BUSN 231. But the instructor, being very suspicious and critical person, suspects that students actually spend less than recommended amount of time. So in order to determine whether or not he is right, suspecting that they spend less than what's recommended, 5 hours, right? He basically asks them, every one of them, how much time do you spend? We record the amount of time. And what hypothesis do we need to test in order to find out if this suspicion is true? Well, again, suspicion constitutes the research hypothesis, our alternative, right? Since we suspect that students spend less than 5 hours a week, that becomes our alternative. So my alternative statement is, time spent per week is less than 5. Average amount of time spent on homework less than 5 hours. So I reverse that statement and becomes null. The average is actually 5 or more. So this is status quo, right? This is normal. An instructor's mind, right? 5 hours or more is good. So that's our null hypothesis. Statement that makes us feel comfortable and warm, so to speak. Okay, so another one. Machine that makes ball bearings is set so that the average diameter of the ball is half an inch. You know what's a ball bearing, right? So ball bearing is a special, I wouldn't call it a device, but it's kind of a component, I guess, the part that has two rings, outer ring and inner ring, and between the two rings there are either metal balls or metal cylinders. And usually it's all pretty well covered in grease so that, the part spins or rotates without much friction. And ball bearings are used in a lot of different devices, like for example in the cars, right, on the axle joints, etc., etc. In order to for the bearing to rotate without much problems, the diameter of the metal balls, right, or the steel balls, should be half an inch, 0.5. If it's too big or too small, problems will arise. If it's too big, so average diameter is above 0.5 inches, and what will happen is all these metal balls will not fit in the in between two rings, right? So therefore there will be tension, and probably it will not spin all that nicely, and eventually probably the amount of stress, you know, in the two rings will destroy the bearing, right? If on the other hand the diameter of the steel balls is too small, that means that there is no tight fit between the two different rings, inner and outer ring, and therefore in the bearing there will be some vibration, some beatings, right? So therefore it will also result in the premature wear off and destruction of the ball bearing. So therefore the diameter of the metal ball production should be right spot on 5 inches, not more and no less. So how can we test if we're spot on? Well, alternative research, do we have a problem, right? So it's not 0.5, it's not the status quo situation, right? If it's too small or is it too large, either way we have a problem, right? So therefore my alternative hypothesis would be that the mean is different from 0.5, from what it should be, and therefore there is a problem in my production line somewhere. Null would be status quo, that's what it's supposed to be, the average diameter is 0.5, and therefore my production is on target. Okay, so again, to repeat the same point as I was doing about 20 minutes ago, testing procedure always begins with an assumption that null hypothesis is true. In the court, jury believes that the defendant is innocent from the get-go. They may change their mind later after they see the evidence, but at the beginning they believe that the person is innocent until proven guilty. Same happens in statistics. Doesn't matter which form, number one, let me go back, yeah, this one, number one, equal not equal, number two, greater than or equal less than, or number three, less than or equal greater than, doesn't matter which form our hypothesis take, we always start with an assumption that the null is true. The goal, of course, is to find out if the sample that we collect about gallons of milk or people watching sports on TV or students' amount of time they spend doing the homework and statistics or diameter of the ball bearings from the production, doesn't matter what we do, the goal is to find out if the sample provides us enough evidence to abandon the null and support alternative hypothesis. Okay. So again, this slide reiterates what we already said at the beginning, right? If the sample about the subject matter, right, is convincing enough, if there is enough evidence in the sample to support the alternative, then we're going to say we will reject the null in favor of alternative. Otherwise, if the sample is not convincing enough, right, then I'm going to still believe the null. I'm going to fail to reject the null hypothesis. So two outcomes is I either reject the null or fail to reject the null. It's always a statement about the null hypothesis. Now, when we fail to reject the null, we don't actually say that null hypothesis is true. Just like when we reject the null, we're not saying that the alternative is true. Okay, we simply never know if they're true or not. Why? Because in order for us to truly know what is the population parameter is, we need to collect data about the whole population. Simple as that. Without full and complete detailed data about certain subject matter, there is no way, simply speaking, no way for us to know anything for sure. Okay, so the only so therefore null is true or alternative is true, we can never make the statement. Null can be false or alternative can be false, we never know. Just basically sample can swing our belief in one way or another way, but it will never tell us 100% with 100% certainty if either one of them is true, if null is true or alternative is true. Okay, so how do we test hypothesis? Well, I told you that sample is my evidence, right? People in court, they look at the fingerprints analysis, at the, you know, footage, video from the security cameras, at the what the witnesses are saying, etc., etc. In statistics, we're looking at the sample. Sample is our evidence. What kind of evidence comes out of the sample? Well, if it's numerical data, then my sample gives me X bar. That's my evidence. If it's categorical data, nominal or ordinal, and I calculate sample proportion, right? Such as proportion of people who voted for Republican, or percentage of people who voted for Democrat, etc. Okay, therefore, what we're doing really is this. If X bar, in this first part of this of the lectures, right, about hypothesis testing, we're going to discuss mostly numerical data. Okay, so X bar shows me what the sample is, but it's never equal to the population mean, right? Sample average X bar, it's never equal to the population average, right? If my X bar is close enough to what I believe the population mean is, then likely I will stick with null hypothesis, right? If X bar is far away from the mean, then I may change my mind, right? If, for example, my students, I believe that students should spend 5 hours doing homework, right, each week. If I take number of students and ask them, how much time do you spend? Let's say students give me different answers, but I calculate that on average they say it's 4.85. Okay, is 4.85 far away from 5? Well, it's kind of not the same, but it's not that much different, right? 4.85. So I may decide that, yeah, you know, it might be just a sample, right? So it looks pretty close to 5, and obviously I'm never going to get precisely 5 average, right? So that's probably close enough. But if, on the other hand, it will turn out that they spent 3.5 hours instead of 5, then I'm going to say, wow, that's a big difference. That's probably not accidental, right? It shows me that real population average, the true average amount of time that students spent doing the homework, is truly different from 5. It's less actually than 5. Okay, so in our hypothesis testing, that's precisely what we're going to be doing. We're going to judge, based on the sample, how far away our X bar is from the hypothesized mean, and from that make conclusions. Does the sample provide me enough evidence to say that mean is not what we claim it to be, or is it close enough so that there is no difference really between what we observe and what we claim about the population mean? Okay. So how we're going to conduct the hypothesis testing? Each time when we formulate and test hypothesis, we need to conclude to compute something that's called a p-value. Now, next phrase that I'm going to say out loud is very important, okay? And we're going to stick with this phrase every time when we test the hypothesis. Here, it's written out there on the slide. The p-value of a test is the probability to observe a test statistic at least as extreme as the one that we compute from the sample, or even more extreme than that, given that the null hypothesis is true. I know that there are a lot of confusing parts in this statement, and we're going to actually see what exactly all that stuff means when we're going to look at the problem, okay? But this is a general interpretation. It applies to all tests, and this semester we're going to do a lot of different hypothesis tests. Each time, this general statement we must formulate in a problem-specific way. Okay, so, and again, in the examples that will follow shortly, I will show you exactly what I mean. But for now, here is one more time, right? P-value is the probability to see the sample average or sample proportion as extreme or even more extreme as the one that I compute from the sample, provided that I still believe that the null is true. Remember when we discussed that 2 times already today. Hypothesis testing starts always with an assumption that the null hypothesis is true. The defendant is innocent. That's our starting point, right? Or the population average is 5. That's my starting point, okay? And the p-value tells me, given that I believe the null from the get-go, from the beginning, what is the chance to see what I'm seeing in the sample, or even more extreme from the hypothesized mean, what is the probability to see what I'm seeing in the sample? And if the probability is very small, then I'm going to say, okay, I believe now, but what I'm seeing in the sample is not very likely. Probability to observe it, well, here it says test statistic, what is it? can be x bar for the numerical data or p hat, right? Proportion from the for the categorical data. So so basically, if the likelihood to see such x bar, given that the null is true, is very small, and I'm going to say, well, my x bar, my sample average, is not very consistent with my null hypothesis. Okay, it's kind of far away. The probability to see such extreme x bar is very small. So now I have two alternatives. I can either believe that I just witnessed a very rare event, right? Likelihood to see what I'm seeing is small, but I can still believe the null and just say, well, every once in a while that happens, which is true. Every once in a while you see extreme sample, right? With very different x bar from the mean mu. And I'm just going to believe that I witnessed a miracle, right? Or another more realistic, I guess, viewpoint is I'm going to say, well, there are no really miracles in life, right? We don't see a lot of them. So therefore, instead of saying that I just witnessed a very rare event, very exotic, unusual sample, let me just say that my null is not true. And that's basically how the hypothesis testing is done, okay? So when I compute the p-value, the probability to see such x bar or such p hat as I see from the sample, then I have to make a judgment call. If the p-value is small, that is the foundation that gives me the right to reject my null. I'm going to say, what I see in the sample is just not consistent with null hypothesis. X bar is too far away from the hypothesized mean mu. That's it, okay? Or p hat, the proportion is just too far away from pi proportion, hypothesized proportion in the population. So therefore, if probability is low, I'm going to reject the null. If probability is not low, then I'm going to say, well, I'm not. What I'm seeing is not a rare sample. Likelihood to see such sample every once in a while is not small. It will happen every once in a while, even if I'm still believing my null. So sample that I'm seeing is not very rare. Things happen. These things happen. So I'm still believing null. So in other words, what I'm saying is this. We're going to reject the null if the p-value is small. Probability to see sample such extreme as this one, or even worse, is very small. Then I'm going to reject the null. If p-value is large, I'm not going to reject the null. I'm going to stick with null hypothesis and say that sample does not provide me with enough evidence to reject the null. Okay? Now, this is branch of mathematics, strictly speaking, statistics, right? So when I say small probability, what exactly am I talking about? 0.5, is that small? 0.3, 0.2, which do I call small, right? So we have to select a measure of how small probability should be for us to say that, yes, this p-value is really small. Well, we're going to always compare the p-value, the probability, against significance level that we're going to select, okay? So significance level, in a sense, gives me the yardstick, the measure. So all p-values which are smaller than alpha, the significance level, I'm going to call them small probabilities. And in this case, as we discussed, I'm going to reject the null hypothesis, right? If the likelihood to see what I'm seeing from the sample is small, it's not very often I see sample extreme as this one, and I'm going to reject the null hypothesis, right? I'm going to stop believing the null. Okay, so when I say that p-value is small, what I mean is it's small compared to the significance level, right? And so therefore, alpha is essentially a measure of a kind of a cutoff point, right? Anything below level significance level alpha, I'm calling small probability. Anything above significance level alpha, I'm calling not so small probability, okay? So, therefore, this is how we're going to conclude the test of hypothesis. We calculate the p-value. If the p-value is less than alpha, we reject the null hypothesis in favor of alternative. Otherwise, if p-value is higher than alpha, it's not very small, we fail to reject the null hypothesis. Again, remember, we have two different possibilities, right? Rejecting the null hypothesis or not rejecting the null hypothesis. Now, one more thing that I actually forgot to put on the slides. So when I'm done with this recording, I'm going to insert the new slide where I'm going to summarize this. But here, what are the typical values of alpha that we are going to use? You probably remember that from Math 125, but the standard value of significance level alpha that statisticians are using by default is 5%, 0.05. Okay. What are the other possible values of alpha that we can use? In practice, there are two of them. Another possible value of alpha is 10%, 0.1. Now, if we're using 10% significance and find enough evidence to reject the null in favor of alternative, these cases we call weak evidence to support alternative hypothesis, right? Because p-value, 0.9, for example, still less than 10%, right? 0.09, 9%. Less than 10%, so therefore we reject the null. But 9% is not very, very small p-value, not very small probability, 9% chance. So therefore, any evidence that is significant at 10% significance level, we're going to call weak evidence. As I said, 5% is normal for statisticians. So by default, this is what we're going to use. It's not unusual, it's pretty normal for statisticians to use 5% or 0.05 alpha significance level. And another popular value of significance level that is oftentimes used is 1%, or in terms of proportions, it's 0.01. So if I test something and I have p-value which is less than 0.01 and I reject the null in favor of alternative, in this case I'm going to say that I have strong evidence to support an alternative hypothesis. So in other words, to summarize, right? If I'm using significance level alpha 10% or 0.1, then in this case I test this I call this type of testing weak testing, because 10% is really kind of large number. Okay, so alpha 0.1, 10%. By default, statisticians are using 5% or 0.05. So this is considered to be a normal and fairly standard way to test hypotheses. And if I'm using alpha significance level of 1% or 0.01, then if I'm rejecting the null hypothesis because p-value was very small, like 0.0005, for example, right? Then I'm saying that I have strong evidence to support the alternative hypothesis. Okay, so that basically summarizes the conceptual portion about the hypothesis testing, and in the next lecture we're going to give it a spin. We're going to look at a couple of practical examples how hypothesis testing is done with real data.